You're listening to The Voluntary Life, where you can hear ideas for finding freedom in an unfree world. Visit thevoluntarylife.com to connect with the show and hear all past episodes. Here's your host, Jake.
Hi, it's Jake here. Welcome to The Voluntary Life. In this episode, I'm going to explain a really useful concept for investing called the variable portfolio. This is especially helpful if you are interested in financial independence and you're following a passive investing strategy. I think the variable portfolio is an idea that can really help resolve a number of the challenges that you face as a passive investor. So that's what I'm going to talk about in this episode. Before I do, though, I just want to say a big thank you to my new patron on Patreon, Pedro A. Thanks to people like Pedro, I'm able to continue putting out this podcast. And if you enjoy the podcast, and especially if you're a long-term listener, I'd really appreciate your support on Patreon. In return, you get access to loads of bonuses, including many bonus episodes. There's a big archive already that you'll get access to as soon as you start supporting. So if you're interested in becoming a patron, you can find out more by clicking the link that I'll put in the show notes or on my webpage, thevoluntarylife.com, or directly on my Patreon page, which is at patreon.com/thevoluntarylife. So on to the topic of this episode, which is the variable portfolio. This is an idea developed by Harry Brown, who was the investment advisor and author who also developed the permanent portfolio investing strategy. And that's the strategy that I follow. And the permanent portfolio strategy is a passive investing strategy. It's a set it and forget it type of approach. And if you heard the previous episode that I put out last week about how to live from investments, then I explained a bit more about the permanent portfolio in that episode. I like the permanent portfolio, but there are many other passive investing strategies where you choose a particular allocation of assets and you stick to it with certain rules for rebalancing if one part of your portfolio becomes too big or too small. And passive investing strategies are great, but they do have some challenges. And that's where the variable portfolio comes in, because the variable portfolio is designed as a complement to passive investing strategies in order to help you to overcome these challenges. So the variable portfolio is not an alternative to passive investing. It's like a complement. And what I'm going to do in this episode is explain the challenges that you face when doing a passive investing strategy. And then I'm going to explain how having a variable portfolio as a complement to your main investing strategy is a way to help you with those strategies. In a funny kind of way, as you'll see as I explain it, the variable portfolio is a way of having your cake and eating it too, by having a passive investing strategy, but still having a way to overcome some of the limitations of that approach and some of the challenges that you face. So what are the challenges of a passive investing strategy? Well, passive investing requires you to be very stoical in the face of changing market conditions. You have to stick to your strategy, and it can be very hard to resist the urge to change your strategy when market conditions change. It sounds straightforward, just set it and forget it, choose the right strategy, and then ignore what happens in the market. But actually, that is an extremely difficult thing to do, as evidenced by the fact that many people who start passive investing fail to carry it through. They get to their first big change in market conditions, and they second guess themselves, and they switch strategies. And it's very hard for people to overcome the urge to respond to different opportunities and threats in investing. When you see your portfolio losing money, it's very hard not to respond to that by doing something. And when you see an opportunity to make more money, it's hard not to respond to that. But the whole benefit of passive investing strategies is that they are designed for the long term. They're not designed to take advantage of small, quick changes. They're designed to be good long-term approaches. And they only work if you stick to it for the long term. Partly because if you keep switching strategies, then you're not going to benefit from being invested in the right assets at the right time to take advantage of them long term. But also for other reasons, passive investing strategies are low cost because there's a low number of transactions. They have a lower tax liability, again, because you're not doing that many transactions. So there's lots of reasons why you need to stick to your strategy, and that's very hard to do. And many people just can't do it. Another reason why it's hard to stick to a passive investing strategy is that if you learn a lot about investing and if you learn a lot about different assets, you see opportunities that you think would be good investments. And it's hard not to take advantage of what you think is a good opportunity, because it's kind of right there in front of you. If you spent all this time learning about economics and learning about investing, then you do have a strong desire to speculate on things that you think must be a good investment based on everything that you know. There's a strong urge to put your knowledge into action and to try and basically speculate and guess the market. Now, obviously, the reason why people pursue a passive investing strategy is because even when you think you might have a great idea, a lot of the time you're going to be wrong, but you might actually be right sometimes. And it's hard to resist that urge to speculate. It's also very hard to resist the urge just to tinker and try and optimize things and do things slightly differently, which again, if you want to be in it for the long term, you have to resist the urge to tinker with your portfolio and just leave it, apart from some very strict rules that you have for rebalancing, for example. So those are the challenges that face you as a passive investor. And the idea of the variable portfolio is to give yourself an outlet for the urge to speculate and the urge to tinker, but only with an amount of money that you can afford to lose. So it's a way of kind of having your cake and eating it too, as I said. Harry Brown had this idea that he realized it was very hard for investors to stick to passive investing strategies. And he realized that a lot of people succumb to the temptation to mess about with their portfolios. So his suggestion was, give yourself a small messing about portfolio, not with money that you need, not with the money that you're depending on for your retirement and so forth, but with money that you can afford to lose. Because that way you can mess about and you can speculate and have an outlet for all of that, but don't do it with the money that you are dependent on for your long-term financial security. And it's a great idea because it means that you don't have to be, you know, a religious passive investor who never speculates. You can still understand the value of a passive investing approach, but just speculate with a little bit. There's a huge ideological battle between passive investors and active investors, and a lot of people are very much proponents of one side or the other. And although I am convinced by the rationale for passive investing, I really appreciate this idea of the variable portfolio because it's a way of dabbling in speculation without risking too much. And in that sense, it means that you're not following a pure passive strategy for all the money that you have, but you still follow a passive investing strategy for the money that really matters, the money that you can't afford to lose. The way that Harry Brown put it is the variable portfolio is a separate, changeable portfolio funded with money you can afford to lose. Its contents vary as conditions change. With the variable portfolio, you attempt to beat the market and earn a sizable profit by acting on your judgments about investment trends. You vary the portfolio's investments as you see the opportunities for profit changing. So how should you set up this variable portfolio? Well, Harry Brown suggested a whole bunch of guidelines for how to work out what you're doing with having a variable portfolio. If you want to pursue passive investing, then you have your permanent portfolio, which, just to be clear, in my case, is actually a permanent portfolio following Harry Brown's permanent portfolio strategy. But you may choose a portfolio which is permanent in the sense that you don't mess around with it, but has a different asset allocation. It might not be gold, bonds, stocks, and cash in the way that Harry Brown's permanent portfolio is. You might just choose to be 100% stocks in your permanent or non-messing about portfolio. But the idea is that alongside that, you have this variable portfolio, which is typically going to be much smaller. And that's where you do some speculation, where you actually try and time the market and so forth. And Harry Brown set out these guidelines for how to think about the amount of money to put in a variable portfolio and how to set it up. It depends whether you're in the accumulation phase of your investing or whether you already have quite a lot of capital. But the basic idea is that you don't put any money in the variable portfolio that you can't afford to lose. So this is only with money that you can afford to lose. What Harry Brown said about the variable portfolio is that if you're in the accumulation phase where you're still developing your portfolio, then the way that he suggested you think about it is to only put money into your variable portfolio from your consumption budget. Don't take away from what you're already doing to invest. So in other words, if you want to start speculating with a variable portfolio alongside your passive investing strategy, the way to do it is to increase your savings rate. So you keep putting aside savings into your passive portfolio just as you have been. But if you want to create a small portfolio for speculations, then just save more. Choose to put aside more into your savings, and that increased amount you can put into a variable portfolio that you can use to speculate with. So that way you stay on track with the saving strategy that you've already got. But if you're willing to reduce your consumption a bit even more, then you can play with that money in speculation if you want to. Again, the obvious point to make here is that this is only an optional strategy. You can also choose to have nothing in your variable portfolio if you prefer. If you've already got some money in savings and you're starting to build up a portfolio and you're thinking about whether or not you want to have part of your assets in a variable portfolio, Harry's idea was, again, to not use any of the money that you can't afford to lose. So, as he put it, the capital that you're counting on for retirement or to pass on to your heirs, I believe you should never take chances with that capital. Never use a penny of it to bet on someone's forecast or to use market timing of any kind. And his suggestion was, think about what you think that money that you can't afford to lose is, and then add an additional 20% to that for contingency, basically. He also provided a softer way of thinking about how much you're willing to lose in the variable portfolio. And he put it like this: how much should you allocate to the variable portfolio? The answer may be obvious to you, but if it isn't, pick an initial figure that seems reasonable and then spend a few minutes imagining that you'd lost it all. What would the loss do to your life? Does the thought of losing the entire variable portfolio unnerve you? Would it change your future? Would it force you to change your lifestyle or your plans for retirement? If so, you've allocated too much to the variable portfolio. Repeat the exercise with a smaller amount. On the other hand, if the loss doesn't seem like much, and if it doesn't seem like any amount allocated is enough to satisfy your urge for speculation, repeat the exercise for a larger amount. Once again, imagine that you've lost it all. Have you gone too far, or can you increase the amount again? So that's a way of finding, in a way, your subjective view of how much is too much to lose. The key thing that Harry Brown talked about always was to find a firm limit for yourself in advance. So to do this calculation up front in investing and not revisit it on the fly. The way that he put it is, an investor, even one who recognizes the risks involved in speculating, is inclined to reopen the question of how much to speculate every time he finds an opportunity, trying at that moment to decide how much he can afford to risk. And if the speculation looks attractive, it's easy for him to overstate the amount he's willing to lose. That's an important reason for making the division between the two portfolios now and keeping the portfolios separate. That way, you'll never be tempted to bet more than you should on any speculation. I think that's a great way of avoiding the emotional side of your brain renegotiating with you when you see something that appears to be a really good opportunity. Another guideline that Harry Brown had about having a variable portfolio is that you never replenish your variable portfolio, your speculations, from your main passive investing portfolio. So if you lose the money that you were speculating with, then it's gone and maybe find a new hobby. But don't take money out of your passive investing portfolio to replenish your fund for speculation. I think those are really helpful guidelines. I would add to the things that Harry Brown said about speculating that my experience has been that the urge to tinker and to speculate investing has gone down for me over time. In a way, the novelty kind of wears off. When you start investing, it's kind of a new world and you can become very obsessed with it in a good way, that you know you're learning all about it. And I certainly immersed myself in that world massively and really wanted to find out everything I could about investing. And as part of that, you want to flex your new knowledge and you want to speculate on things too. But the urge to do that over time for me has definitely gone down. And it depends on what your investing is for as well. If you see investing as being a means to an end, a means to give you the freedom to do other things with your life, then as long as it's working to give you that freedom, then the rest doesn't really matter that much. I think that's a really important thing to think about for yourself. What is the purpose of investing for you? Is it just to keep making more and more? Do you have an urge to beat other investors so that you can get prestige and status points? I mean, is it kind of a game for you? Because that's the kind of dynamic that drives you to keep tinkering and speculating and trying to beat the market, in a way, because you're competing. But I think it's really important to keep in mind what the end game is, what the goal of all of this is, and how much is enough for you. Because you do have other things to do with your life other than trying to make money. And making money can consume your entire life. You can spend your whole time, once you're financially independent, just messing around with your portfolio and speculating. And life is finite. You only have so long. And so you're losing the time that you could be spending on the other things that are meaningful to you. What about your relationship? What about your kids, if you have any? And what about all of the other dreams and hopes that you have? What you can do with your life, with the freedom that financial independence gives you. If you're willing to live relatively frugally, then once you get to the point where you are financially independent, then don't forget to stop messing around with your investments and start living, because that's what it's really for. I do have a small variable portfolio, and a few years ago, it was a good outlet for me in terms of some investments that I was curious about and interested in and wanted to speculate in. And I'm happy with the way that those speculations turned out. But having done those speculations a few years ago, I don't really do anything new now. I'm not speculating anymore. However, I do think that having a variable portfolio is a great complement to a passive investing strategy. And the nice thing is, it's entirely up to you as to how big or small that variable portfolio is, and whether or not, you know, you don't want it at all now, but you might want to have a small variable portfolio in a couple of years' time, you can do that too. So it's all up to you. But I hope that hearing about this concept gives you some flexibility as a passive investor, so that you can stick to your guns and stick to your strategy and not get sidetracked by tinkering and speculating. But you can still have a small outlet with money that you can afford to lose to help you stick to your guns where it really matters in your main passive portfolio.
Thank you for listening to The Voluntary Life. If you like this podcast, please show your support by becoming a patron of The Voluntary Life on Patreon. Your support will help to grow and improve the show, and you'll get access to a treasure trove of rewards, including bonus episodes. Visit thevoluntarylife.com to learn more.